Okay, so this video is going to cover how to find the unknown side of a right triangle. And the way that we find an unknown side of a right triangle is by using Pythagorean's theorem, which is one of the most famous theorems there is in math. Most people have heard of it, and it does apply when you have a right triangle. Now, do be aware that either in the instructions for the problem, it does need to state that you're dealing with a right triangle, or you do need to have that little square in the corner of the triangle like we have here that signifies it is a right triangle, because this theorem can only be used with right triangles, no other kind of triangle. Okay, so we do need to make sure that we do have this situation. And as long as we do have a right triangle, right, so we can find one of the missing sides. So we can either be solving for the sides of the triangle here, which are actually known as the legs of the triangle, or we could be solving for this diagonal side over here, which is actually called the hypotenuse. Right, very interesting word there. So we're either solving for the sides or we're solving for the hypotenuse, which means we would have to have two out of the three sides of it. So we're either going to know one side and the hypotenuse, or we're going to know both sides and we're solving for the hypotenuse or something like that. We do need to have two out of the three pieces of information there. And as long as we have that, we can use Pythagorean's theorem to find the other side. And Pythagorean's theorem looks like this. It says a squared plus b squared is equal to c squared. Well, a and b, as far as this formula is concerned, a and b are the legs of the triangle, so they represent the sides of the triangle. It doesn't matter which side is a, which side is b, just pick one. I typically just, whatever the first number that my eyes go to on the side here, I say that one's my a and the other one is going to be the b. Now C is always the hypotenuse, every time. That will never change. So this C squared here is always your slanted side there. The A and the B are always the sides. Okay, so let's go ahead and work the problem that we have here, and we're going to plug into this formula. Okay, so we need to plug and chug into this formula, so we're going to plug in for a first. I'm going to say that 6 is going to be a, so that's one of my sides. So plugging into the formula, that would give me a 6 squared plus, right, that's part of the formula, plus b squared. So then since I use 6 as a, that means 8 has to be b. So next I would have 8 squared. And that's going to equal c squared. Now c, we don't know what c is. That is what we're solving for. So c is just going to stay a c in our formula just as is. So we have 6 squared plus 8 squared equals c squared. So that's how you plug directly into the formula. Next step, after you plug it in, is you do need to simplify this formula. So using those order of operations, right? I think most people have heard the acronym, please excuse my dear Aunt Sally, which tells us the order in which to simplify expressions, equations, that sort of thing. Which, for this particular formula, that would just mean here, we have exponents and we have addition. So exponents, or the e, comes before the a. So the first thing we need to do here is go ahead and take care of those exponents. So we have 6 squared, which means 6 times 6, which is 36. We also have 8 squared, which is just 8 times 8, which is 64. Drop down that plus sign in between them, and that still equals c squared. Next thing we would do is go ahead and take care of that addition. 36 plus 64 is 100. So we have 100 is equal to c squared. Now, we do need to remember here we are solving an equation. We do need to get an answer, c equals so and so. So using our steps of solving an equation, we're done simplifying. We need to get c all by itself, and we're almost there. We only have that c squared. So then we need to remember, how do we get rid of a square? So we need to remember this here. In order to get rid of a square and a square root are opposites of each other. So if I have a square, I can take the square root to get rid of it. If I have a square root, I would square it to get rid of it. They are opposites of each other and would cancel out. So over here on the right hand side of my equation, we have c squared. We need to get rid of that squared, so we're going to take the square root of it. But remember the golden rule of solving an equation. What we do to one side, we must always do to the other side. So I need to take the square root of the left hand side as well. Well, on the right hand side, the square root and the square cancel out, leaving us with c. And on the left-hand side, the square root of 100, well, that happens to be a perfect square. If you plug that into your calculator, you will get a 10. All right, so that means that that side C is equal to 10. Okay, so let's work on another example. So taking a look at the triangle we have here, we do have that box in the corner of it. It does signify that it's a right triangle, so we're good to use Pythagorean's theorem here. Taking a look at this one here, we were given a leg of the triangle, so we're given one of the sides, and we're given the hypotenuse, right? So we're solving for the other side for this particular one. So plugging into the formula, remember the two sides are your A and your B. The hypotenuse, the slanted one over here, is your C. So plugging into our formula, the first thing we have is an A squared. So I'm just going to say that 21 is going to be A squared. So I'm going to plug in 21. For A, don't leave off that exponent, so that's 21 squared, plus B squared. Now, we're obviously solving for the other side here, so that B squared is actually just going to stay as is in the formula. It's what we're solving for. We don't know it yet. And that's going to equal C squared, and C here for this particular problem is a 27. So equals 27 squared. Using order of operations, we need to clear up our exponents first. Okay, so 21 squared, so 21 times 21 is 441. Drop down that b squared, we're not ready to mess with that yet. And that equals 27 squared, so 27 times 27 is 729. Okay, so we're solving for b. So in solving equations, remember, we need to isolate the variable, get it all by itself. So in order to get B all by itself, we need to get rid of that 441. It's a positive 441, so remember, when it comes to moving things around in equations, we do the opposite of what we have. So since we have a positive 441, we're going to subtract a 441. And what we do to one side, we must always do to the other side. So 441 minus 441 is going to cancel. You're going to get 0. That's going to go away. So we drop down b squared is equal to, we had 729. We're subtracting 441 from it. So we get 288. Okay. So the only thing we have here, we have b squared equals to 288. We still need to get b all by itself. It's not quite by itself because we have that exponent there, that square. And remember, to get rid of a square, we take the square root. And what we do to one side, we must always do to the other side. So on the left-hand side, square root and square cancels. We're left with b. And on the right-hand side, we have the square root of 288. So we would get, using your square root function in your calculator, just plug and chug that away. Depending on what calculator you have, sometimes you have to press the square root first. Sometimes you do the number first, then the square root. So play around with your calculator. Otherwise, the square root of 288, I'm getting 16.97. Depending on your instructor or depending on what book you're using, some books do tell you to round to a certain decimal place. So I would say pay attention to that. If it does not, I would go with just rounding to two decimal places. That's kind of typical. So that means that this side here would be 16.97.